Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Holy Spirit, you welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, you welcome. Holy Spirit, you welcome. Oh Lord. Oh, Holy Spirit, you welcome. Holy Spirit, you welcome. Holy Spirit, you welcome. Oh Lord. Can't sing right until you come.
Give the Lord some praise. How many of you know the Lord is still worthy to be praised? Amen and amen. Thank you for joining us this morning for our Black History Service of Celebration. Time, continuity, and change. Black resistance. Amen. Once again, good morning. At this time, I invite all of our Claflinites to please stand. All of our Claflinites. Let us give the Lord a praise for all of our Claflinites. I extend now the invitation to all of our guests to stand and to be recognized. Everyone is at home. To God be the glory. Amen. Amen and amen. On behalf of the pastor and members of Sandhill United Methodist Church, we welcome all of you, our guests, our members, those online and those in person, for joining us and celebrating and worshiping with us today as we celebrate Black history. May you feel the presence of our Savior and the love, the hospitality, and the joy of a congregation who truly loves God, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. My beloved friends, know today you are welcome. Amen. At this time, a few reminders and a thank you. We sincerely appreciate your prayers, words of encouragement, visitations, calls, and donations, food, monetary service, flowers, etc. We are grateful for all the expressions of love during a time when we needed it most. Words can never express the gratitude that we felt to know that you had us on your mind. We were moved and comforted by your expressions. Please accept our sincere thanks and love. You are greatly appreciated. May God continue to bless you. Agape love to you, Brother Malachi Perry and family, with a hearty thank you. Amen. To God be the glory. We are reminding all of our members that on Thursday night of this week, we will be at Trinity United Methodist Church in St. George at 7 o'clock with the Reverend Jerry Harrison. And we do ask that you please prepare to be there as we celebrate with the Reverend Jerry Harrison and the Trinity United Methodist Church family. And on Wednesday of this week, we will begin our Lenten Bible study, and all are invited to participate. And we are reminding you that on this evening, 7 p.m., we will begin our community Lenten service, 7 p.m., Wesley Latson. Amen? Everyone is invited to participate. At this time, let us receive Sister Louise Salter with the occasion.
I am the black child. I am special. Ridicule cannot sway me. All right. I am strong. Obstacles cannot stop me. I hold my head high, proudly proclaiming my uniqueness. Yeah, sure. I hold my pace, continuing forward through adversity. I am proud of my culture and my heritage. I am confident that I can achieve my every goal. I am becoming all that I can be. I am the black child. I am a child of God. Yeah. Poem, Michael Wynn. Good morning.
Good morning.
Giving honor to God, Reverend Sally, Reverend Geddes, my Sandhill United Methodist Church family, visitors, and especially our speaker for today, Dr. Henry Tisdale, President Emeritus of the illustrious Claflin University. The occasion. Well, the occasion this morning is the culmination of our annual Black History Month celebration here at Sandhill United Methodist Church. What is Black History Month? Black History Month is an annual celebration of achievements by African Americans at a time for recognizing their central role in U.S. history. February is Black History Month. This month is special for all African Americans because our history is being celebrated nationwide. This occasion is our way of reminding our children that the struggle Black Americans endured was real. All right. The story of Black History Month started in 1915 after a century after the 13th Amendment abolished slavery in the United States. That same year, historian Carter G. Woodson co-founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History. In 1926, the group declared the second week of February as Negro History Week. Thus, Black History Month evolved from Negro History Week. Since 1976, every American president has designated February as Black History Month. February was chosen because it coincided with the birthdays of both Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, and not because it's the shortest month. To God be the glory for this recognition, because it took years to happen, and even today, many still don't see the need for it. Today marks the conclusion of Black History Month 2023 at Sandhill United Methodist Church. The Black History Month 2023 theme, Time, Continuity, and Change, Black Resistance, explores how African Americans have resisted historic and ongoing oppression in all forms, especially the racial terrorism of lynching, racial pogroms, and police killings. My brothers and sisters, never forget these words. Those that fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. Winston Churchill. Finally, I want to share with you these words from my late parents to their children. No matter how high you go and where you go, don't forget where you came from. So I say to you young people today, don't ever forget where you came from and always be proud of your heritage. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Louise. Amen. You are now invited to stand as you're able for our call to worship. My Lord, what a morning. You have raised up a mighty nation and a mighty people. My Lord, what a morning. You have brought us through the dips and hollows, up and down the streets, over the hills and mountains and through the valleys. My Lord, this morning we have come to celebrate you, to affirm ourselves as images of you in all your glory, and to say, yes, Lord, we are strong, proud, brave, and yours in every way. We count it all joy. Let us give the Lord a hand praise. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we extend the invitation to the Reverend Roosevelt Geddes, who will lead us now with our morning invocation, followed by our core response. Amen.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come this morning before you with bowed heads and with humble hearts, thanking you, Heavenly Father, for all of your many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. We thank you for bringing us over hills and mountains. We thank you for bringing us through the valleys of the shadow of death. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for how we came this far by faith. We know that it was not our strength that brought us thus far, but it was your grace and your mercy that you looked beyond all of our faults and you saw our need. And you promise long before you leave this world that you would be with us always. Yes. And Master, you certainly has been with us. Yes. Because we know that the road was not easy. We had a hard road to travel. But through it all, we made it this far. And this morning, as we celebrate this Black History program, we pray that our young people and those who were not around during the struggle through life thus far knew it was a hard road, and we made it thus far. And we are thankful for God's mercy. We are thankful for those who've gone on, who lay down their lives for us. Thank you, O God, for the part that I played and others in this community. We pray, O Lord, that you will bless us all and help us to continue to look to the hills from whence cometh our help, and realize that all of our help yet comes from the Lord. Help us not to take our eyes off the prize. Let us stay focused and strive for excellence. These blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 And amen.
I was born by the river. change is gonna come. Oh, yes, you will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid. Up there beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know the change is gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movies and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming. But I know a change is gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. And I go to my brother. And I said, brother, help me, please. And my brother winds up knocking me. And I got on my knees.
Do you believe a change is gonna come? If you believe it, come on and give the Lord some praise. Thank the Lord for the change in advance. Thank you, Brother Gavin. Thank you, choir. I invite you now, as you're able, to stand as we sing with uplifted voices. Lift every voice and sing.
Let there be water.
standing for our litany, led by Sister Linda Wilson. Amen.
Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us read, as printed in your bulletin. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, Thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, Thou who hast by Thy might led us into Thy light, keep us forever in Thy path, we pray. Even as the worlds were formed, continents named, oceans separated, and your plan for humankind began to unfold, you had us on your mind.
Thank you, gracious Lord, for your divine plan.
When you decided to perfectly place man in your world, you chose to place him in our motherland. Throughout the Holy Scripture and throughout our history, we have witnessed your keeping power, and we have been recipients of your love and grace.
Thank you, gracious Lord, for including us in your divine plan.
We shall ever be mindful of how you brought us together after the Middle Passage, delivered us from the chains of slavery, and carried us through the Civil Rights Movement. We thank you, dear Savior, for the gifts, talents, uniqueness, and cultural blessings you have poured out upon our people.
May we always appreciate the blessings you have bestowed upon us, O God.
We thank you for our mathematic, scientific, and literary genius. We thank you for jazz, gospel, and the blues. We thank you for beautiful locks of hair and beautiful shades and complexions of skin, and even for soul food. We thank you for the wisdom, strength, and determination we learned from our ancestors, and for the blessings and love of family, O God.
And we stand together, O God,
as corporate family and love to remember, reflect, honor, and celebrate the heritage, history, and legacy you have given to us. And we ask that you, O Lord, will keep us forever in Thy path. We pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated at this time. Let us receive our mass choir.
Asked the Lord to help me to be strong. Called him over. night long. Yeah, all night. One more time, listen. Jacob wrestled with the angels all night long. He wouldn't let go till the break of dawn. Said you're gonna bless me before you leave. I felt the same way when I was on my knees. I asked the Lord to help me to be strong. All day, all night long.
Bless the name of the Lord. Amen. It is now time for the introduction of our speaker. You may find the entire biographical sketch in the program. I will not read that. That is for you to review at a later time. Amen. I'm making that clear. Years ago, Dr. Benjamin E. Mays, President Emeritus of Morehouse College, explained that each one of us can reach our level of true greatness if we know what greatness is and if we know our innate abilities. Dr. Mays said wealth, p- position or power are no measure of greatness. Greatness is defined by what we have become and what we have been. The people who close this gap we call great. Even though these words were penned years ago, I am grateful that they have lived in the mind, the heart, and the soul of a visionary leader, President Emeritus of Claflin University, Dr. Henry Tisdale, a native of King Street, South Carolina, one who has closed the gap and has demonstrated excellence as a visionary leader. Dr. Tisdale has a proven track record of success as the 8th president of Claflin University. One of his well-known mottos of life and leadership are the words, "The world needs visionaries." These words shared by Dr. Tisdale challenge each one of us in our chosen profession to become not just the best we can be, but to become movers and shakers in a constantly changing world. My beloved friends, today, we give thanks that Dr. Henry Tisdale demonstrated his greatness as a visionary leader, as a scholar, as a mathematician, as an educator, as a humanitarian, as a transformative leader, and as an advocate for justice and diversity, to name a few. Ladies and gentlemen, after the singing of the next selection by our mass choir, let us receive Dr. Henry Tisdale, President Emeritus of the Claflin University. Sandhill, let us welcome him. To God be the glory. Thank you.
Good morning, Sand Hill. Thank you, Reverend Sally, for a very gracious and excellent introduction. Giving honor to God, to Reverend Sally and members of Sand Hill United Methodist Church and Christian Friends. I thank you for inviting me to be a part of your Black History celebration. You really look good this morning. I mean, all the colors and the dashikis and the like. You look like you have been celebrating and still want to continue to celebrate Black History Month. You know, I've been to this church several times, and I always enjoy worshiping here. Now, see, you remind me of my home church in Kingstree, South Carolina. I mean, you know, at St. Paul United Methodist Church, people were not too proud to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Through songs and praises, making a joyful noise. noise. I mean, you didn't have to be quiet throughout the service. So I enjoy being in this beautiful edifice here with you today. This morning, I bring you greetings also from Trinity United Methodist Church in Orangeburg, South Carolina, where our pastor is the Reverend Dr. Eddie Williams. And I want to just acknowledge the Claflin University alumni and to say to all of you that I bring you greetings on behalf of the current president, President Juan Warmack. Thank you. Just a little test. Just a little test. And of course, I bring you greetings from our alma mater, Claflin University, one of the oldest historically black colleges or universities in the state of South Carolina, and one of America's best colleges. And thank you for such a wonderful theme for this celebration. Time, continuity, and black resistance. Now, speaking of time, continuity, and change.
Yes, sir.
And black resistance. When we think of time today, we're talking about our history in this country, about 400 years, by the way. Continuity from 1619 to 2023, change, what's been the progress? What's been the real change and the true equality that we've seen over the years? And of course, black resistance speaks for itself.
Yes, sir.
Most times when we think about our history and the origin of black people in the country, our mind takes us really to our community, if you will, around here, the Low Country, Charleston, South Carolina. And it should, because 40% of all of the African Americans enslaved entered this country here in the Low Country, entered on Gadsden Walk, a place where we know the International African American Museum is going to open any day now. But I also want to say that, you know, our history didn't, as you know, begin here in the Low Country or the Deep South. The history of black people in this country began in 1619 when a ship delivered about 30 enslaved Africans to Jamestown, Virginia. And these enslaved Africans were purchased by white Virginians in the year of 1619. That was the origin and beginning of the national story of African Americans and the enslaved in this country. And I would add that it's the origins of our discontent and, yes, our black resistance. Black people were here in this country a year before the celebrated Mayflower transported the pilgrims from England to the New World. That was in 1620. Black people were here 113 years before the birth of President George Washington. Black people were here 244 years before President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. All right. Black people were here in this country, can you believe it, 344 years before Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave his I Have a Dream speech.
My Lord.
We've been here for a while. Now the resistance, that is, and the fight for freedom and justice didn't just begin with the civil rights movement of the 1950s and the 1960s. Yes, there's been continuity from 1619 throughout enslavement and beyond. You know, black people were looking for an escape. I mean, they weren't happy and satisfied with enslavement. They were looking for an escape from pain, suffering, and discrimination through any means possible. No, we were not happy about the situation. In fact, you know, there are many major episodes of black uprisings and rebellions and escapes and attempted escapes documenting black resistance.
All right.
Now here in our part of the world, the Low Country, there were several notable rebellions. The Stono Rebellions of 1739 near the Stono River, just about 20 miles southwest of Charleston. You know, about 60 slaves resisted and went on a rampage killing more than 20 white people. Unfortunately, in a short period of time, the slaves were killed and captured and executed. They were resisting enslavement.
Yeah, yeah.
In 1822, still in our part of the country here, we know of the Denmark Vesey Rebellion in Charleston about 100 years ago, 1822. It was a plan to revolt that included more than 1,000 free and enslaved blacks. You know the result, the rebellion never happened. The revolt never happened because a slave spilled the beans about the plan.
My Lord.
Denmark Vesey and 30 slaves were tried and executed for just thinking about raising an insurrection. We all know the story of Harriet Tubman, the Moses of her people, and the Underground Railroad. Well, the story of Harriet Tubman is really one about resistance. People wanted to get out of this place to a place where they could be free.
Yes, yes.
And then some of us know about this one. Some of us, not all of us. There was the Great Migration from 1916 to 1970. Now, some of you were around in that period of time. Maybe not you. But some of us were around. The Great Migration was the movement of some 6 million African Americans from rural areas of southern states of the United States to cities of the North, Midwest, and West. We left the South and went to Philadelphia, Detroit, Chicago, Cleveland, Baltimore, New York, California. Some even went on up to Canada. Now, the Great Migration was black resistance seeking freedom and justice. Now, I said, now, Reverend Sally wouldn't know anything about that, but you know, I was a part of the Great Migration in 1965. After graduating from Claflin University on May 26th of 1965, I boarded the Silver Meter in King Street on May 27th of 1965. And I waved goodbye to South Carolina. I was resisting and seeking opportunities with no plans to return.
My Lord.
Now, of course, how did I get back here? You know, we have our plans.
All right.
Yes.
And God has his plans.
Yes.
And it was God's plan for me to return to South Carolina to lead my alma mater, Claflin University, into the 21st century. Thank you. But let me add here that in spite of the challenges and struggles, you know, we had triumphs.
Yes, sir.
We've seen change. And that brings us to Black History Month. And you heard the story of Black History and Dr. Carter G. Woodson and the celebration of Black History Month beginning in 1976. Now, I say to us that we need to tell this story to our children. And today, as we celebrate Black History Month, we must also, you know, yes, let's talk about the triumphs, and we'll talk about the resistance, and also lift up the tragedies over time. Now, I'm aware that there are some people who would like to see Black History Month go away. In some places, it's even against the law for schools to celebrate Black History Month. But I say, we still need to remember the struggles, challenges, tragedies, and the resistance. Now, I know, you know, Reverend Sally, when we come to church, we don't want to hear any bad news. There are some of us who just don't want to hear any bad news anytime. But I believe that we have to tell the whole story, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Even during our Black History Month celebration. It may be the best time, by the way, for us to do it. Now, poet Maya Angelou said, and I quote, "History, despite its wretched pain, cannot be relived or unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again." The quote reminds us that we cannot change the past, yet we know of the struggles that we must remind ourselves and our children of. We know of the challenges and tragedies that we just cannot deny. And let me just mention a few, just to make certain that we lift these things up from time to time. We cannot ignore the tragedies. We must not forget the transatlantic slave trade that transported between 10 and 12 million enslaved Africans across the Atlantic Ocean, and with about 25% of those not even surviving the trip. We must not forget the dehumanizing act of our ancestors being sold on auction blocks like property and having families torn apart while being treated as less than human. We must not forget the back-breaking work in the cotton fields, the rice paddies, and the indigo fields from sunup to sundown, many times working in very treacherous conditions. Let us not forget. Let us not forget the lynching and bombings, the tragedy of segregation followed by Jim Crow, Black business districts throughout this country, Black prosperous business districts being burned to the ground or destroyed otherwise. We must not forget or ignore the continuing education gap, the wealth gap, the health gap, and other social justice gaps. And we must today respond to the national movement to undermine and weaken the Voting Rights Act. You know, I discovered in 2013, after my mother died, that the most precious piece of paper that she possessed, based on the way it was kept, was her voter registration card. Now we take it for granted, but that was her most precious. But in spite of it all, and especially to our young people, we've seen change. And today, I'm optimistic, and I believe that America is still a place where all things are possible. That real change and true equality are still embedded in the American dream. That we can affect positive change in our communities and worldwide if we have the courage, confidence, and the tenacity to fight for it. No one will give it to us. We must demand and command positive change. Let's not be afraid to claim our piece of the pie. We must believe, by the way, that God is on our side. Yeah. must remember Joshua 1 and 9. Have not I accomplished, have not I commanded thee, be strong and with courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. Senator Cory Booker said a couple of years ago, he said, challenges of race in America cannot be addressed if we refuse to confront them. He said, persistent biases cannot be defeated unless we combat them. He said, the arc of the universe does not just naturally curve towards justice. We must bend them. Sometimes we must resist, that is, bend the arc in our favor. Now, over time, when we look over the continuum, we see that, yes, many things have changed in the country, but please keep in mind, these changes came about as a result of many years of struggle and resistance. Somebody had to fight for them, die for them. Let us not forget the Emancipation Proclamation, 1865. You know, sometimes we think that, well, President Lincoln was the great emancipator. We should be glad for that. But you know, the real story is that in 1862, there was a civil war going on. Lincoln was president. Things were not going well. And he had to figure out a way, how do I get out of this? Well, you know, Lincoln called a number of black leaders to the White House, black leaders to the White House to talk about the problem. Well, to the dismay of the black leaders, when they got to the White House, President Lincoln said, you know, the problem is really you black folks. I mean, they thought they were coming to the White House to help solve a problem. He said, you folks, you're the problem. And it's only if you would agree to go, leave the country, leave the country, go back to where you came from, the problem would be solved. But thank God on that day, these black leaders confronted the President of the United States and said emphatically, they resisted. They said, no, Mr. President. They said, this is our home.
Yeah.
And this is our country. They said, beneath this soil lie the blood, sweat, and tears and bones of our mothers and fathers.
Yes, sir.
Here we were born, and here we will die.
Yeah.
That was black resistance on that day. And then, of course, we're all aware of Brown, the 1954 decision, Brown versus the Board of Education, which declared that separate but equal was illegal. And you know, it really was about 20 families, families in Clarendon County who stood up and demanded equality. I mean, so this whole Brown versus Board of Education started right here in South Carolina, in Clarendon County, who said, we want equality. We don't want inferior condition. Courageous, resisting, black resistance. And the 1964 Civil Rights Bill came into being after the Birmingham movement and after much black resistance. The 1964 Voting Rights Act, by the way, I was at Clapham University when all of this was going on. I was at Clapham University when we as students at Clapham University and South Carolina State University, we were in the streets resisting every day, going to jail between classes and the like. These things happened after black resistance. In spite of the struggles, I want to come back again and say, some things have changed and we need to be reminded of that. We have excelled as a people, and we have much to be proud of today. You look like you are proud today, but you know, it's only been about 400 years short period of time. Since our ancestors were enslaved and brought to this country in chains, I believe that as a community, as black people, that we have achievements that can rival any found in any community around the world. Achievements in amassing black wealth, in educational attainment, in entrepreneurship, in corporate representation, and in political leadership. Yes, there has been progress. And I'll cite just a few more. Who ever thought it could happen? I didn't. I didn't believe that I would ever see in this country, that I would live to see a black man becoming president. Yeah. But in 2009, he became president. Now there's a black woman who's the vice president.
Yeah.
And we also have a representative, Hakeem Jeffries, a black man, elected minority leader of the United States House of Representatives. And believe it or not, today we have four black Fortune 500 company CEOs. Not enough, we need more. Today we have black billionaires. But in case I miss somebody in this church, I'll just name a couple. But we have black billionaires. I mean, we all know Oprah got the money. And then there's Robert Smith, a graduate of Morehouse. Billionaires, and there are others. That's progress, but not enough when we consider the widening wealth gap. That the poor getting poorer and the like. The gap between whites and blacks in terms of real wealth. And what about just a few weeks ago, we saw two black quarterbacks facing each other in the Super Bowl. We didn't think that would ever happen. They said we couldn't play quarterback. We couldn't think to play quarterback. Two black quarterbacks. Progress, but not enough. When we consider the number of coaches, the limited number of coaches based on the number of black athletes that are playing in professional sports today. Now, in spite of the progress, I would be the first to say there are still battles to be fought and victories to be won.
Yes, sir.
No, Reverend Sally, we didn't overcome yet. We still need to fight for changes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, there are times when we ought to fight and ought to resist. We cannot forget that our journey from enslavement to freedom has been like Dickens' tale of two cities, one of tragedy and triumph, pain and perseverance, the worst of times and the best of times.
Yes, sir.
We must tell the whole story. At our dinner tables, we must lift up, especially to our children, the fact that the legacy of black Americans is rooted in a story of excellence and contributions. The narrative of challenge and triumph must be passed to our children and future generations because it provides them with a clearer focus on the strength and resilience of black Americans rising from a tragic past to a place of triumph and victory despite our valley of experiences. The list of black American triumphs is lengthy. People who were worthy or defying the odds. I could go on and on. We know of Frederick Douglass, who at the time it was illegal to teach someone, a black person, to read and write, and he taught himself, and he taught others. We know Mary McLeod Bethune, a university now named, always named in her honor because of her vision. And of course, we know the story of this country having a black president because President Obama, Barack Obama, he had the audacity to believe that he could become the president of the United States of America. The audacity to believe it could happen. We've gone from being told that, blacks, can't succeed in a certain position, like the quarterback position, because of their intellect and lack of leadership ability, to seeing two of them, of course, winning the Super Bowl. And I won't say who won because maybe it may not be your team. So I won't say that. But we need to remember that African Americans have excelled in every conceivable field of human endeavor,
yes, sir,
and achievement. They've made significant contributions to the nation and the world. Every era of American history is marked by great African American artists, poets, philosophers, authors, educators, physicians, scientists, musicians, preachers, inventors, singers, dancers, politicians, and athletes. But it came about with a lot of black resistance. Let us not forget, every advance, every improvement in our quality of life and access to levers of power came because of our struggle.
Yes, sir.
And let us remember the words, and they're in your program today. But let's remember these words. These are very important words of Congressman John Lewis, who advised us. He said, "Do not get lost in a sea of despair. Be hopeful, be optimistic. Our struggle is not the struggle of a day, a week, a month, or a year. It is the struggle of a lifetime. Never, ever be afraid to make some noise and get in good trouble, necessary trouble." Words of John Lewis. You need to keep them in mind. And he was talking about your theme today, time, continuity, and change, and black resistance. The poet Maya Angelou, in her poem, "And Still I Rise," offers us words of encouragement when she says, "You may write me down in history,
yes, sir,
with your bitter, twisted lies. Yes. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still like dust, I'll rise." Langston Hughes, in his poem, "Keep Your Hands on the Plow, Hold On," says, continue to fight. He's trying to tell us to resist. He said, "Keep your hands on the plow, hold on. If the house is not yet finished, don't be discouraged, build it. If the fight is not yet won, don't be weary, soldier. Better die free than to live slaves."
Right.
James Weldon Johnson, in his song, "Lift Every Voice and Sing," says, God is with us. God is on our side when he says, God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever on the path, we pray. May we forever stand true to our God,
yes,
and true to our native land. This morning, I want to leave you with Deuteronomy 31:6, which says, be strong and of good courage. Fear not, fear nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that doth go with you.
Yes,
he will not fail you nor forsake thee. Therefore, we must not despair, my friends. We must rise up. We must resist and demand that America live up to its creed that all men and women,
yes, sir,
are created equal.
Yes.
Let us vow that the temporary oppressions of the day will not keep us down. Yes, let us join hands, brothers and sisters, and walk hand in hand, believing that we shall overcome,
yes, sir,
through time, continuity, and change, and yes, black resistance. Thank you.
Amen.
our musician play softly. After hearing the word of God today, if there is one who would like to join in as a member here at Sandhill Moving to Discipleship, that invitation is extended. And if there is one today to give his or her life to Christ, that invitation is extended as well. Is there one today? Hallelujah. Let us give the Lord some praise. Sister Tanya Jackson comes today to reaffirm her membership here at Sandhill. Sister Pat, would you join me? Uncle Malachi, will you please join us? Amen. Hallelujah. Let us give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. We thank God. Amen. So today, as we join together, Sister Tanya comes to renew her membership here at Sandhill, and we thank God for bringing and drawing her here today. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And because you are already a member, we will just reaffirm your membership vows. Amen. As a member of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church, the local church, Sandhill United Methodist Church, and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If you will, say, I will, by God's help. Amen. As a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If you will, say, I will, by God's help. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you for Sister Tanya, and thank you, dear God, for allowing her to come forward this day to renew her membership here at Sandhill United Methodist Church. We do not take this lightly. And we say thank you for sending your daughter here this day. She's been faithful. And dear God, we just say thank you for touching her heart to step forward this day to renew. We give you glory, honor, and praise. Now help us as a congregation to nurture her in the faith and help us to strengthen her daily. In Jesus' name, we pray and give you thanks and praise. Let everyone say amen, 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 and amen. To God be the glory. What a blessing, amen? Amen and amen. At this time, let us prepare to bless our offering, our tithes and our offerings. Gracious God, we do thank you again for this day. Thank you for our offerings today that we have already received online, by mail or in person. And we thank you, dear God, for the offerings we will receive as persons exit today. Help us, dear God, to be good stewards of what you have blessed us with. In Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praise for all of these blessings. Let everyone say amen. Amen. Let us now receive Sister Brenda Robinson Drayton with our remarks.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. On behalf of the Sunday School Department, Education and Higher Education Committees, we would like to acknowledge and thank Reverend Sally for allowing this program. We would also like to thank our speaker, Dr. Tisdale, for his participation in our service. We receive your message, Black Resistance, Black History, and Positive Change. To those who participated on the program, we thank you. To the committee members and anyone else that played a part in making this program a success, we thank you. Last, a special thanks to each of you in the congregation, our mass choir. Thank you for the following songs. We'll open us up in Holy Spirit. You're welcome in this place. Followed by A Change Is Gonna Come. Then lift every voice and sing All Night. I call on the Lord, the King, ride on King Jesus, and lastly, break every chain. The musicians, we thank you. Reverend Geddes, in his absence, we thank him. Visitors and friends for worshiping with us today. We pray that God will continue to bless each of you and your family. Again, thank you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's been a great morning, and we thank God for the move of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Dr. Tisdale, for spending part of your morning with us, and we pray God's blessings upon you. Amen. Amen. I teased him earlier. I said, since your retirement, you have a different look. He's well rested, and we give glory to God for that. Amen. Amen. But great job, great job. May we now stand, all hearts and minds clear. We do invite you, as you're able this morning, to Canaan for the women, United Women in Faith, as we celebrate there this morning. The Reverend Wilhelmina Thompson, pastor of Macedonia United Methodist Church, will be the guest speaker at Canaan for the Women's Day program, as you're able. Hallelujah. Let us now look to the Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you again for what our ears have heard and our hearts have received. We go forth now thanking you, dear God, for your word today. Thank you for the vessel, Dr. Tisdale. Continue to restore him. Thank you, dear God, for allowing him to pour into us. Now, dear God, help us to go forth, being agents and vessels of change wherever you shall lead us. We pray now that your covering be upon us. Whether it's far or near, take care of us all. Father God, as we look around the sanctuary, we want to say thank you for bringing those who have been sick back into your storehouse. Sister Nora, Sister Sadie, thank you, God. And dear God, I just ask now that your hands be upon Brother J.D. Glover. Father God, you know all situations. Have mercy upon him. And be with this entire church family, is thy servant's prayer. In Jesus' name. And Father God, I ask that you be with my mom this morning, who wasn't feeling the greatest. You know, God, and I ask that you have mercy upon her. Father God, thank you now. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 And amen. Let us receive our acolyte. go forth in God's peace.